to the world of Serenity's equalization. DDR5 is finding out you can't just brute force signals as they've done with, you know, DDR in the past, the single-ended. And you're finding now with DDR5, it's like, oh, we need to put some equalization in there. And, well, maybe we need some at the receiver end too, a DFE. And now you're starting to talk Serenity's. And the Serenity's world learned a long time ago about trying to do channel simulations with, you know, convolving the bit pattern with the pulse response. They're starting to try to figure out how to do that. Or actually, we have tools. Keysight, we have ADS has a channel, a bus simulator, I call it, for DDR. And because it's not a channel simulator specifically, it uses the same technology, but DDR has parallel clocking. It's not clock data recovery. And so the traditional channel simulator doesn't quite work. And so there's some extra tricks in there that you have to do with the parallel clocking. But you use that convolution technique with the pulse, PRBS pattern with the, or not PRBS for DDR5, but use your bit pattern convolved with your pulse response. And you get a lot of insights very quickly, and you can see how that channel's performing. So I think in terms of DDR5, it's coming, it's staying. Obviously, every time the cloud server farms get bigger, everybody's into that business, and more data going faster and faster. Obviously, DDR has to keep updating and improving the speed and density and everything. So with DDR5, I think you're just going to continue to see more and more of the Serenity's techniques coming into designing and analyzing those DDR5 systems. Circuit boards, I think the fascinating thing to watch with printed circuit boards is the level of creativity going into the stack ups and the control that we're starting to see now of what materials, low profile copper, all your dielectric materials. We're getting away from finished hole size. We can actually specify drill sizes, so we know exactly what the size of that hole is for EM simulations. And a lot of these, better and more precise control of the fabrication process lets the high-speed designers be more confident in getting repeatable performance every time. And that's, I think, part of what DDR is going to need, because you have hundreds of lanes and they all have to perform equally. So that becomes more of a control of quality across, say a printed circuit board panel, or from panel to panel, so your product doesn't change over time. The other thing I think that's kind of interesting is that with DDR5, obviously if you shorten everything down, you're going higher speed to keep the same loss. You just run shorter traces. But shorter traces also mean you can get more ringing between transmitters and receivers, and you don't have as much room to route things. So I think the challenge, especially for DDR5, again, is looking at some of these advanced techniques that the Serenity's layout people are doing to, you really have to start looking at very good, well-controlled fabrication processes and design rules for the routing. Right. And in the RF microwave world and high-speed digital, we did that a long time ago. We try to stay with half-ounce copper because now your etch profile is better controlled. If you're trying to etch down through 2 mils of copper on the top of your printed circuit board, you're going to get sort of, if it's gold-plated, you get a mushroom shape. If it's silver-plated, maybe you get the Mesa type, wider at the bottom of the trace than the top. And so a lot of those things, if you go internal to the board with strip line and half ounce copper, you get very good etch definition. If you shrink things, it goes faster. And I think as long as you can maintain the quality, shrinking things down basically does, without really changing much of the topology, you can get up to higher frequencies. So that is sort of the fastest way to keep the performance maintained as you go up in data rate. So hyperlinks actually is a little bit more of a hybrid. They're using some 2D or algorithmic models a lot of time to try to speed up that simulation. And I would say hyperlinks is a great, with Mentor, they're a manufacturing printed circuit board layout tool integrated in with company production logistics and all of that. And, you know, hyperlinks, you push a button and your layout designers can check things. But I think one of the challenges is engineers often need a tool where they can really get in there and understand what part of a layout is controlling performance. How do you get the innovation and the insight to change, to improve things for your next design? How do you get that competitive edge with another company if you're just pushing a button and not really understanding the engineering behind it? And so with ADS, we actually let engineers look at the problem from different directions. It's very easy to actually modify the layout in real time and hit simulate again for the engineer. And so that's our goal, is to really integrate the ability to bring in a board, bring it into an EM tool, get out, export directly into a schematic analysis. We have a new memory designer tool that is net driven. So you can bring in hundreds of, you know, net connections and make your transmitter and receiver connections with all of those bus lanes. And then also, run the EM model on that, bring it back into schematic, hook it up to your channel simulator. And then if you think you found something in layout that you don't like, you can go to the layout, change the copper around, and then do that whole process and automate it if you want to. So the idea is to really enable the engineer to have the feedback he needs to gain insight into what's really controlling the performance of the design. So machine learning, I think management at every company, every big company out there is trying to figure out how they can invest, how they're going to make money, what it can do for them. Obviously, there's a lot of people dreaming fast about how wonderful AI is going to just solve all of our problems. And I, as an engineer, where you're trying to analyze, hundreds of nets, or you're looking at all this data, you're thinking, oh, if I could just push a button and have an AI just look at all that data and come back with the answer, it would be nice. So I think in the future, definitely, we're every company out there, a lot of investment going into it. You look at the chips coming out of like NVIDIA for AI, the automotive industry is definitely pushing that technology very fast. The processing power is now fast enough to do the AI algorithms. And so you'll see, I think, a huge bump in even our industry to try to figure out how can we start gathering all of our knowledge base and feed it into those engines to assist the engineers. The obvious answer to me is, well, everyone should have this tool. If you're an engineer, you should have an engineering toolbox. I think sometimes I compare it to the idea of an engineer has a technician. They can do a lot of work together. And that was a model that we used to grow up with. And nowadays, it's a lot of engineers don't get the luxury of a technician. But simulation software is not cheap. CAD software. But if you look at it from a point of view of you don't have to hire another engineer, you're augmenting an engineer's toolbox. We have a great support network with our software. We link on also with our instrument partners and all of that support network. So when you invest in simulation software, you're not just investing in a niche point tool to do something. You should also consider the fact that that's a resource. Get on that tech support hotline. Ask questions if you get stuck, and don't be shy. That's we're coining it Keysight Care, and we're looking at that future of how do we enable our customers to really make use of the instruments and software that we can provide them with. Well, obviously what you want to do is that first design. You want to understand the design rules, and so initially the first one's going to maybe take some time to figure out those design rules. But if you define exactly and understand what's controlling the performance, then you can make very good decisions about what design rules the layout designer needs to follow. Then you want to try to automate it more. And then it becomes a much faster process to just run it through these tools for a quick check rather than having to actually analyze the what's controlling the performance. As a female engineer in the world, growing up, I never used to try to think of myself as being different. I think most of us, it's human nature, you want to fit in. I've always liked, tinkering and building and making things. And I went to, Caltech. There were not a lot of women there at that time. And as someone I wanted to fit in, I basically, I don't know if I pick up some of the habits, but I feel quite comfortable in that engineering world, and I don't really see men, women, whatever. It's I see engineers, and I love the discussions that ensue from that. I was lucky enough. I did have a professor in college, Dr. Rutledge. He's RF microwave professor. Has a lot of famous students at different universities around the world. But what was interesting to me is he actually did make an extra effort to get women engineers into his research groups. And I did a senior thesis with him. One of his grad students was Arthi Prabhakar, and she ran NIST for a few years. So, and DARPA, she was there at DARPA also. So anyways, he was probably one of the ones that was very instrumental in helping in my career, helping with women in engineering. But I think what I would like to say is I would rather see women focus on the job. I would rather see us spend time going to technical conferences than conferences that are just for women. I think I do a lot more writing papers for a technical conference and putting on seminars and boot camps like I did yesterday to educate the industry rather than worrying too much about where people come from or what background I'm trying to move forward.